Hello and welcome to this, the last of our online services for the season of Christmas. This coming Sunday, the Sunday is the second Sunday after the Epiphany, and that marks the last of the end of the Christmas season. Last week was the Orthodox Christmas, and some people were happily celebrating Christmas. Last weekend, I have some friends from Ukraine and friends from Russia, and they were both celebrating. Also, one or two friends who are Greek Orthodox priests. So we've still got the spirit of Christmas, and this is going to be reflected in our first hymn, 316 in the Church of Scotland hymnary, Love Came Down at Christmas. Now we turn to scripture for our edification and enlightenment. And our first reading comes from, well, actually, the only reading actually comes from, sorry, I should say the first reading. And it comes from Isaiah chapter 49. The servant of the Lord. Listen to me, you islands. Hear this, you distant nations. Before I was born, the Lord called me. From my mother's womb, he has spoken my name. He made my mouth like a sharpened sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me into a polished arrow and concealed me in his quiver. He said to me, "You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will display my splendor." But I said, "I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing at all. Yet what is due to me is in the Lord's hand, and my reward is with my God." And now the Lord says, "He who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him and gather Israel to himself. For I am honoured in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has been my strength." He says, "It is too small a thing for you to be my servant, to restore the tribes of Jacob and bring back those of Israel I have kept. I will also make you a light for the Gentiles, that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth. This is what the Lord says, the Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. To him who was despised and abhorred by the nation, to the servant of rulers, kings will see you and stand up. Princes will see and bow down because of the Lord, who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you. Well, that's quite a moving passage, and it's one of the servant songs, the servant Messiah songs, and it's again emphasizing that the Messiah, the coming Messiah, is going to come not as a mighty emperor or even a powerful general of great armies, but as a humble servant. Now, our next hymn is 319. It's a lovely hymn for our the end of our Christmas season. 319, of the Father's love begotten. Now to our gospel passage from the Gospel of St. John, chapter 1, verses 29 to 42. John 1, verses 29 to 42. Hear the Gospel of Christ. The next day, he saw Jesus coming towards him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks ahead of me, because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John the Baptist testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God. And the calling of the first disciples. The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Behold, the Lamb of God!" The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." And they came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," they translated the Anointed One. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which translated is Peter. Well, thanks be to God for this, his glorious gospel. Well, let us pray first before we look at this passage. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. In John 1 and verse 29 we read, "The next day John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, 'Behold the Lamb of God who is taking away the sin of the world.'" Well, here is the second appearance of Jesus during the period which we call Epiphany, which just means showing forth. By this time, Jesus' baptism and his temptations were in the past, and Jesus was about to start the work which he came to do. He was about to start his ministry. Once again, John's Gospel, the fourth Gospel, shows John the Baptist paying fealty and tribute to Jesus. Significantly, he calls Jesus by that tremendous title which has become woven into the language of devotion, the Lamb of God. So let us look at this title, what it meant at the time, and what it means for us today. We might ask, what was in John's mind when he used that title? Well, there are at least four Bible situations that we can consider towards an answer. First, it may have been that John was thinking of the Passover lamb. The Passover feast was not very far away. The old story of the Passover was that it was the blood of the slain lamb which protected the houses of the Israelites on the night when they were due to leave Egypt. On that night, the Passover night, when the angel of death walked abroad and slew the firstborn of the Egyptians, the Israelites were to smear their doorposts with the blood of the slain lamb, and the angel, seeing it, would pass over that house. The blood of the lamb delivered them from destruction to freedom, from slavery to freedom. The blood of the Passover lamb delivered the Israelites in Egypt from death And it may be that John was saying, there is the one true sacrifice who can deliver you from death, the Lamb. Paul too thought of Jesus as the Passover Lamb in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 7. There is a deliverance that only Jesus Christ can win for us. The second reference to the Lamb of God. John was the son of a priest, John the Baptist, son of Zechariah. He would know all the ritual of the temple and its sacrifices. Every morning and every evening, a lamb was sacrificed in the temple for the sins of the people, the Lamb of Atonement for their sins, bringing people to be closer and at one with God. So long as the temple stood, this daily sacrifice was made. Even when the people were starving in wartime and in siege, they never omitted to offer the lamb. Until that is, in AD 70, when the temple was destroyed by the Romans. It may be that John is saying, in the temple, a lamb is offered every night and every morning for the sins of the people. But in this, Jesus is the only sacrifice which can deliver people from their sins. So, a third reference to the Lamb of God. There are two great pictures of the Lamb in the prophets, Jeremiah writes, but I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter, Jeremiah 11 and 19. How prophetic. And Isaiah has the great picture of the one who was brought like a lamb to the slaughter, Isaiah 53, verse 7. Both these prophets, Jeremiah and Isaiah, had the vision of one who by his suffering and his sacrifice, Jesus' sacrifice on the cross, sacrifice meekly and lovingly borne, would redeem his people. Now, possibly for these prophets, they thought, well, that was only going to be the children of Israel, the tribes of Israel and Judah. But we know that this vision is extended to include the Gentiles, as we read in our Isaiah passage. That means all the peoples of this earth. And it's certainly true that in later times, the picture of Isaiah 53 became to the church one of the most precious forecasts of Jesus in the Old Testament. And so it may be that John the Baptist was the first to see this also, to see Jesus as the fulfillment of the Messiah prophecies in Isaiah. There's a fourth picture which we can look at, which would be very familiar to Jewish people, although very strange to us. Between the Old and New Testaments, there were the days of the great struggles, struggles of rebels against invasion called the Maccabees. Israel had been invaded by Greeks, by the Greek armies, and then replaced in defeat by the Roman armies. In those days, the lamb, especially the horned lamb, was a symbol of a great conqueror amongst the Maccabees. It was like their warfare logo. Judas Maccabeus is so described, as are Samuel and David and Solomon. The lamb, strange as it may sound to us, stood for the conquering champion of God. Perhaps this is why they expected the Messiah to be a mighty general, a leader of armies. It may well be that this is no picture of gentle helplessness and weakness, but rather a picture of conquering majesty and power. Jesus was the champion of God who fought with sin and mastered it in a single contest on the cross. There is sheer wonder in this phrase, the Lamb of God. It haunted the writer of the book of Revelation. 29 times he used the reference to it, the Lamb of God. It becomes one of the most precious titles of Jesus Christ. In one word, it sums up the love and the sacrifice and the triumph of Jesus. John says that he did not really know Jesus. Now John was a revelation of Jesus, and he must have been acquainted with Jesus somehow, as cousins. What John is saying is not that he did not know who Jesus was, but that he did not know who Jesus was. It had suddenly been revealed to him that Jesus was none other than the Son of God. Once again, John the Baptist makes clear what his only function was. It was in humility to point people to the Messiah, to the Christ. He, John, was nothing, and Christ was everything. John claimed no greatness for himself and no place for himself. He was only the man who drew back the curtain and gave Jesus the center stage. What does this mean for us Christians today? It means that we should try to do the same, to point people to Jesus Christ, to prepare the way and guide their footsteps in the direction of Jesus and his church. For without the church, how are newcomers going to grow in the faith, grow from being pagans into Christians? Christian survivors of New Age cults say the same thing. As soon as people try to bring Jesus into the discussion, there is a pulling away by the cult, and the last place a New Age cult member will be seen alive is in the church. It's almost as if stepping into a church is a betrayal of the other cult members. We are not surprised by that. We have read about such alienation from God in many instances in the Old Testament records of cults. Even when cult members have come to me for help, they just cannot take that final step of commitment to Jesus and his church. But there are many, many more people in the world who God leads to us, and who God sometimes leads to us in the church. We are to welcome them, share the faith and love of Jesus with them. I said faith and love of Jesus, and then to show them his acceptance. Acceptance is a basic human need. And if we do, then they will be saved. They will be saved. Great is the mystery of faith, and great is the saving love of Christ. The whole Gospel of John was written for no other reason than to reveal Jesus to us, to provide a space for us to encounter Jesus in his full identity, fully human and fully divine. Jesus, God and man. the author clearly tells you in John 20 and 31. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing in him, you may have life in his name. Well, thanks be to God. Well, let us now sing a lovely hymn to an old Scottish Highland air. It's hymn 724, hymn 724, Christ's is the World. Now let us turn to God in prayer. Let us pray. The Feast of Epiphany brings the Christmas season to an end, and as we move on into the Christian year, I'm going to share with you first of all a poem. It's called Now the Work of Christmas Begins. The poem is composed by a philosopher and pastor called Howard Thurman, an American theologian. When the song of the angels is stirred, when the star in the sky is gone, when the kings and princes are home, when the shepherds are back with the flocks, then the work of Christmas begins. Begins to find the lost, to heal those broken in spirit, to feed the hungry, to release the oppressed, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among all peoples, to make a little music with the heart, and to radiate the light of Christ every day, in every way, in all that we do, and in all that we say. Then the work of Christmas begins. And so we pray. Shepherd God, who protects the flock and searches tirelessly for those who wander from the fold, retrieve the lost and bring them home. Loving God, wrap your loving arms round those who are broken-hearted, depressed, or feeling that no one cares about them, and fill their hearts with your peace, joy, and love. We also pray for all those whose lives have been devastated by the pandemic and economic collapse. We're called to feed the hungry. Faithful God, we pray for everyone who is hungry today, far away or in our local communities. We pray for those who share this earth with us, but for whom hunger is a crippling, life-threatening danger. We pray for those who have nothing and those who have too little to eat. We give thanks for the generosity of those giving to charity and food banks. We are called to release the oppressed. Almighty God, who has created us in your own image, give us grace to fearlessly fight against evil and never to accept oppression. Help us to employ our freedom and the maintenance of justice in our communities and throughout the world. We are called to rebuild the nations and to bring peace among all peoples. Creator God, we pray for those countries that are being torn apart by war and terrorism. We ask you to bring about changes that would bring peace and restoration for both populations and cities alike, especially in the Ukraine war. We are called to make a little music with the heart. Father God, we especially pray for our own role in doing the true work of Christians. May we be the ones who radiate the light of Christ every day, in every way, in all that we do and in all that we say. Merciful Father, accept these prayers we offer for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, our closing hymn is 782, Spirit of God. Thank you. now we ask for God's blessing on our lives as we go about our ways throughout the week. Let us pray. May we go forth into the world in peace, to love and to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and remain with us all. Amen. Well, thank you for joining us, and we look forward to the next online service, which will be next week, and I think we expect the Reverend Stephen, my colleague, the Reverend Stephen Sass, to lead us in that one. Thank you, everyone.